Amen, amen, amen. Oh, come on, y'all. Shoot. Listen, I thought Rufus already broke up the black stuff that we had to do, just prerequisite, you know what I mean? Like, I thought maybe it's because he's the older version, you know what I mean? You just disrespected the younger version, you know what I'm saying? So let me just once again help you. The EPC has integrated, and guess who's at your dinner table? So amen, everybody. Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. I'm Tim Johnson. I am just delighted to be a part of this lovely denomination. I get the privilege of being the leadoff hitter here for us at GA. And maybe not the leadoff hitter. Maybe that's not so appropriate. But maybe I am the first leg on this relay. And so I get the benefit of coming out the blocks hot. Kind of come out that thing hot. And then I'm gonna pass that thing to Corinna and Rufus and Eli and Sandy. And we're all gonna take turns passing the baton. And I think that's gonna be real apropos to the very first thing that I want to encourage you today with from God's word. Let me read for you 2 Timothy 2, verses 1 through 2 real quick. And if you have your papyri with you, if you've got your ESV, NIV, NLT, whatever it is, pull it out. You got your cell phones. And let me read for us 2 Timothy 2, 1 through 2. Paul addresses his protege, his young son in the ministry, Timothy. He says, "You then, my son, be strong, be strengthened in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. And the things you have heard me say in the presence of many witnesses, entrust those things to reliable people who will also be qualified to teach others." This is God's word. Thanks be to God. Listen, as we gather here today, I know that we are here to take care of a lot of business this week. There'll be a lot of logistics and a lot of position papers and conversations and budget alignments and all those things that we as Presbyterians do. But our perpetual charge as ministers of the gospel of Jesus Christ is the guiding and the nurturing and the shepherding and the equipping of the body of Christ to fulfill their purpose. And that primarily is going to come through the ministry of his word. Everybody say the ministry of the word. It's going to happen both in public and in private. And it's going to be based on us being faithful to pass on the truths that are contained in our sacred scriptures again and again and again and again. This is the song that doesn't end. I'm sorry for the ill-timed humor. This passage is primarily about us doing our part in this cosmic relay until we reach the finish line. Amen. Paul starts off and he says, "Hey, young man, the things that you have heard me say in the presence of many witnesses." Paul commands Timothy, his spiritual son, to take whatever he's heard, all the lessons in public and private, and I want you to share it with others. If you spent any amount of time in the Pauline corpus, then you kind of know that and you recognize that this is just another instance of what Paul's imitation theology is like, right? He's always encouraging someone in this passage, namely Timothy, to just do what I do. Say what I have said. Timothy, you don't have to create it. What you've heard me say, repeat it. Amen, somebody. 2 Timothy 1:13 just says, "Follow the pattern of sound words that you've heard from me in the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus." These words, these things, air quotes, we haven't defined yet, but they'll serve as the locus of my talk today. And they are the things that Paul is encouraging Timothy to entrust to other reliable, qualified people who intend to share them with other people. Once again, Paul taught publicly and privately. So this wasn't just side conversations that he's having with his young man, Timothy, but he's taught openly, right? And he says, "You remember those things that you heard me say, not just in secret, but in the presence of many people, many witnesses." Now, why are those things important? I believe that Paul, every time he opened his mouth, he probably was like a shotgun and those little pellets sprayed everywhere. And he didn't care. He set the hose on a mist so that not that it would just focus on one thing, but when he opened his mouth to share the gospel, he wanted the truth of God's word to fall on all who had an ear to hear it. But in this particular passage, 2 Timothy 2, verses 1 through 2, Paul says this is not the shotgun approach. Paul says hey, I spoke certain words, these things in the presence of many witnesses, so that those could testify, as one scholar said, to the soundness of those words and to the fact that those words are the truth of God that should be passed on. You know what's happening? That's Paul, the dude responsible for writing most of the New Testament, saying that I'm not too high and mighty, that I don't need to not just preach to a bunch of people who have a lesser theological education than I do. I don't always need to preach where I'm the smartest man in the room. Sometimes I need to preach to my peers, and I need to let my peers validate whether what I'm saying is off or not. Yeah. Because you do know that it's possible for even the best of us to switch up a little bit. I hear you laughing, but I'm telling you the truth. So it's possible for drift, I heard, is subtle. You know, you wade in the pool, before you know it, if you're not paying attention, you've moved from 3 feet to 4 feet to 5 feet to 6 feet. And sometimes I need to preach to people who can help me say, hey, buddy, we need to come on back over. So Paul says, hey, I've got to preach this thing. I got to preach it in the presence, in public, of people who know what should be passed on to people. Essentially, what I'm saying is these things, y'all, are things that are inherent to any organization, any group, any movement, any subculture, any culture have things that are inherent and built into its DNA. And Paul is saying to young Timothy, hey, those things that you've heard me say, you've got to pass it on. I used to have this annoying football coach. I don't want to call his name because you might be pastoring him somewhere. We used to get in our film sessions, he said, hey guys, you know what we got to be able to do this week is when we go out there, we got to be able to do those things. Those things, guys, those things. And I'd be like, man, what are those things? He was always just say those things. It's like, what are those things? Well, let me just help you. When we talk about these things, the things that Paul is talking about in verse 2, what we're talking about, if you will, is just gospel elements. This is not just our soteriological lens, but this is the network of beliefs that shape the gospel. Maybe we know this from 2 Timothy 3, that when Paul talked about the scriptures with Timothy, he was also talking about all the Old Testament, right? 2 Timothy 3:14, but as for you, continue in what you've learned and have become convinced of, because you know those from who you learned it, and how from infancy you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation in Christ Jesus. When Paul was talking about those things, he was helping young Timothy understand redemptive history as he framed up all of the Old Testament scripture that pointed towards our great King and Messiah. He helped him understand that Israel's promised Messiah was also the redeemer of sinners who were undeserving and thus became the king of the cosmos. He was helping young Timothy and all of his audience with gospel morality, right? Keller quotes in Generous Justice, he says that those people who have right standing with God are committed to putting right relationships together in all forms of their life. That means they are committed to treating all image bearers with equity and fairness and generosity, right? He helped young Timothy understand gospel morality. He helped young Timothy understand the gospel indicatives, all the things that were true because Christ has now died, that young Timothy, you are loved, you are accepted, you are known by God, and don't even let them despise your youth, young Timothy, because I've chosen you. Come on, man. He helped young Timothy with a systematic theology, the theology of sexuality in Romans, the theology of marriage, 1 Corinthians 7, the theology of work, Colossians 3. He helped him systematically. He helped him understand the character of God, Colossians 1, that we have the supreme being of the universe who is without origin. He's infinite and he's limitless in his power, but he's also the same God who's compassionate and gracious and slow to anger, and he's abounding in love and faithfulness. He helped young Timothy understand what we were supposed to do with that. What do you do with a God who's blessed us with so much lavish riches and we were so undeserving? As Romans 12 says, our reasonable response to the greatness and the mercy of God is to present ourselves as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to him. Paul says you take those things and you entrust them to other reliable people. What does it mean to entrust? It just means to make a deposit. Everybody say, make a deposit. Y'all need my account number? Okay, all right. Just want to make sure you're still awake. It means to commit to one's charge. He says, take those gospel elements, take the network of beliefs that shape our gospel and our ethos, and you commit those to other people for safekeeping and for transmission. We'll get to other. When you entrust something to someone, you give something of value to someone who also respects that value. When you entrust something to someone, you take something of value and you give it to someone who respects and honors that value. We learn really quickly how to appraise values. I've got three beautiful kids. I'm married to this awesome woman who ghost wrote my script, my sermon. So if it's bad, blame it on her. But I got three awesome kids, and one of the coolest things watching my kids grow is they learn very early how to appraise and assess value. They would leave our arms, and my daughter, she's about 4 years younger, I think, than my middle son, I think. Am I right, baby? It's okay. Sorry. That's right. But, you know, she would leave our arms. You know, we would be busy. We vacuuming, and, you know, we cooking, and then, you know, they wanted to be good big brothers, and they'd be like, come to me. But we'd be doing things, multitasking, and then we'd give her, and then she would get into their arms, and immediately her body would tense up. That baby said, I know my life is in danger. This man can't hold me. He can't hold me. We know. We learn how to appraise. We learn how to assess value very early. And we know who respects the value. And we know who we're safe around. And we know who we can entrust. Paul says you got to take these gospel elements. You got to entrust those things to reliable people. You got to give those to people who have the capability and the character not to fold under external pressure. You got to take the gospel elements and you have to give those people and give those gospel elements to people who have enough self-control not to break under internal pressure. Give it, entrust it to people for safekeeping. Is learning, even in a systematic class on Christology. Why does the gospel need to be in safekeeping? Well, because we know that if you start tampering with the gospel, you will undermine it. One of my professors said, if you damage the person of Christ, you will eventually undermine the whole gospel. This is why if you are going to be serious about word ministry and the transmission of our sacred gospel elements, you have to be a custodian. You have got to be committed to understanding that this thing can be diluted and polluted. We preach to everyone who would give us an ear to preach, but we have to entrust our sacred elements to reliable people. We see more of this. 1 Corinthians 4, Paul talks about himself and Cephas and Apollos as stewards of the mysteries of God. In 1 Corinthians 4 and 17, he goes on to say that, hey, for this reason, I've sent Timothy, my son, whom I love. Why? Because he's faithful in the Lord, and he will remind you of my way of life in Christ Jesus, which agrees with what I teach everywhere and in every church. It's not judgmental for us to be able to discern who's faithful and reliable and who's not. Paul would preach the gospel to anybody who had an ear, but he's only entrusting it to reliable people who are faithful. Come on, y'all. Paul has to instruct Timothy in this way because he knows the gospel will not spread itself, nor will it protect itself. The gospel will not spread itself, nor will it protect itself. The gospel's been given to us to be stewards of it. Tim Mackey from the Bible Project, as he does those great videos, just said about 2 Timothy. He says, following Jesus involves risk and sacrifice. It means inviting tension and discomfort into our lives. And I think this is such an appropriate letter to bring this into as we get imagery of farmers and soldiers and workers later on in this chapter. Amen, somebody, if you know that there's some sweat equity. There's some fatigue in working in word ministry. Because guess what? As long as there will be truth, there will also be lies. And as long as there is word ministry, there will always be opposition to that truth. We will always have people who will turn away from that truth. Externally, we'll always have people who oppose our messages, and that brings about fear. Two Sundays ago in my pastoral prayer, I read from the EPC's statement on sexuality, and all I could tell you was that before I read it and while I was reading it, all I was experiencing was fear. And when we experience that fear, will we continue to say what we know to be true? We also know, because we have opposition, because those who uphold the truth are frail. Do anybody know we're frail in this room? We're always in danger of capitulating to the dissenting voices. We're always in danger of making concessions to the itching ears. We're always in danger of lowering our arms and loosening our grip on the truth. And with so many lies, it's inevitable that some of those lies make their way into our pews. And when they do, will we alter what we once believed to be true, or will we hold fast? Friends, we have to be vigilant. We have to ask the Lord to give us discernment to detect where fear and fatigue and falsification might be infiltrating our word ministries. One commentator just says, faithfulness negatively consists in they're not losing, neglecting, ignoring, or falsifying what Paul has said, and positively consists of their handling accurately the word of truth. As we entrust these gospel elements to people, we have to entrust our message to individuals who can teach sound doctrine and refute those who contradict it, which means we got to stay sharp. We got to stay in the spiritual gym. Let me see you flex a little bit. That means you got to keep your weight up. You got to stay sharp. It can't be like when your church have fellowship and y'all play kickball on the fifth Sunday and you get out there and like, it's been a little while. If you're in word ministry, you got to stay sharp, my friends. We got to honor the gift. He says this to young Timothy. In the second chapter, he says, do your best to present yourself to God as one approved, a worker who does not need to be ashamed and who correctly handles the word of truth. Spurgeon says that if any man will preach as he should preach, his work will take more out of him than any other labor under heaven. Are you still serious about your word ministry? And I know you don't have to write exegetical papers anymore, but your work and word ministry is still as consequential as the day you graduated seminary. And it's still as consequential as the day you stood in front of the presbytery and you were examined. But these qualified individuals are not just to be gatekeepers, but they are to go on the offense. And they are to make this message, take this message and share it with others who intend to teach others. I recently became a little cautious about a potential heresy that could be in our midst. The women of our church were talking about organisms living in refrigerators and sharing it with others. And I said, we must find out about this. Only to find out that's how I got my sourdough bread. So good. So good. Y'all keep spreading that. Just keep spreading it. But you know, they get real particular about the club. They don't just broadcast it to everybody. It's just individual texts. Because they never share the starter unless they know you intending to use it. First, they start with, hey, you like making bread? Because depending on that answer, it's going to let me know how we're going to move. You don't need what I have. Oh, I'm preaching lice and wolves. Far be it from the EPC to ever be known as the fat cats who gather and we just wow each other with our oratory presentations and we have no intention of sharing it. May it never be said amongst us. Everything that has been written for us, God has intended for us to share, even from Deuteronomy. Therefore, choose life. Hold fast to my words, because my word brings life to the world. It's a great preacher from another denomination who had this beautiful imagery. He said, man, I just saw a vision of a man in a casket holding the baton. He said, we got too many brothers, too many sisters dying with batons in their hand. Y'all, we have to share our gospel elements. Because who else will? I've been cared for and discipled by a lot of amazing people. Some of them are in this room. The Gibsons, Dan Burns, Scott Seeley, people who've taken interest in me, my besties in the room, people who love me. But I have a really unique relationship. I have a mentor who's probably one of the best preachers I've ever met in my whole life. Met him on a gospel hip-hop tour. And I, you know, struggle with my follow-through and my follow-up sometimes. I know no other lead pastor struggle with that, just me. But this man, I rarely call him. He's usually calling me. And when he calls me, it's usually, hey, Johnson, how's it going? How we doing? What's going on in Memphis? Okay, man, yeah, that's good. And then he says, well, do you know about, and then it just starts with a whole 50-minute conversation, and not a conversation, but a sermon. So it's a 50-minute sermon, and he just goes, and 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 goes. It confuses me. To this day, I'm still confused because I want to know why it is that someone who has made more money in his itinerant ministry in probably 1 year than I make in 5 years, why is it that he's so serious about calling me? Because he's serious about gospel transmission. He is serious about making sure that that baton is out of the casket before he goes. That he cares more about gospel transmission than he cares about his time. I wonder if he saw that anywhere. Maybe through the Lord Jesus, who did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but he emptied himself. I'm out of time. But if we're going to be serious as Christians and not just as a denomination more, then we've got to be serious about sharing this truth that we have. And is it as valuable to you that you would be willing to get as creative and selfless and determined as you possibly could to share with other people? I recently in ministry found myself at a deficit. I don't have enough time. I don't have enough strength. I don't have enough wisdom. I don't have enough compassion to love and pastor people who are hurting me. I don't know what to do. And I don't know who you are. I just got good news for you today. That if anybody in here is serious about word ministry, the good news is you can't be serious about word ministry without understanding that that word is for you too. Paul starts this verse in verse 1 by just saying, hey, young man. He don't just give him the command. He said, hey, young man, be strong in the Lord. Be strengthened, Timothy, by the grace. I just want to remind you who have been charged to take the word and entrust it to other people who will teach it with others that everything God has commanded you to do has been undergirded by his strength. And he has not based the propagation of his scripture on your wit or your intellect or your determination. Oh, but by the grace of God that will supply you with everything you need according to his riches and his glory. Would you bow your heads with me? Thank you for giving us your truth. Thank you for giving us the grace to share it. remind us of the value that it is to us. Our daily bread, your very word spoken to me. And I'm desperate for you. And I'm lost without you. Father, we need you. And there's no way that we can be faithful to your commands without you. Teach us the value of what we hold, and give us the grace and empower us to share it until we cross the finish line.